I kind of wanted to try a different approach to like the usual presentations that I've seen about free and co-free. And I think, you know, a lot of presentations, and I mean, they're all good presentations, but they kind of start from like the high level of, you know, just like working with effects and monads and just like generalizing from there. And I think that gives like a good useful, you know, kind of a concrete use for it. But I kind of wanted to try a different approach with this. And I kind of wanted to build up from smaller pieces of looking at trees. And I tried to keep this talk fairly simple. Hopefully you should, you know, you might need to know what like a functor is, like capital F functor, like with a map, and kind of know what trees are, and, or have seen trees. I mean, is anyone unclear about either of those things? I mean, trees from like a high level, just like, you know, tree data structure. I might, you know, I'll just go over that kind of briefly. But so basically when I think of trees, and this is kind of like an exploration of me just kind of like walking through this process. So hopefully, you know, you can kind of explore with me a little and kind of maybe it'll help. It's helped give me an intuition for these things. So maybe it'll help someone else. But, you know, I wanted to like look at trees and, you know, the components, like the bare components of like the minimum viable tree is that you have to have some sort of value, like a leaf of some sort. Then you have branches, and you also have recursion in this data type, you know, some tree data type. And just like, you know, kind of what this minimum viable tree might look like would be just like a data tree. You'd have the leaf. I'm just, you know, keeping it with int for now. And given some branch, this may be just like branches, just like a fork, and it has a recursion on the tree. And this is just kind of like what it might look like if you were building this like in PureScript or Haskell, you know, this data type, using it. You just branch. You have this nesting, and down at the leaves, you have the actual values. And so here's my crude ASCII diagram of kind of what this might look like using it, where you have like little dots or the branches. And then out down at the bottom, you have the integers. And, you know, I don't know about you, but when I first saw this, you know, I had seen this before, just like reading some things on like trees and free stuff. And to me, this like data type looked pretty useless. You know, because it's basically like a list, you know, just 1, 2, 3, 4. It's really only leaves, but there's all this extra structure that ends up looking like this. So I've basically got just values, but I've got this all this structure around these values. And one way to look at this is, instead of just like maybe just like a list, this is kind of like a list, but it preserves the operator associations. And so if you look at this and think of the branches not just as just branching, but as some sort of operation, like in our case for this tree, it might just be like a basic pairing, like this comma operator in the previous slide, or like tupling, basically. This is just building up a pure data structure. But you can kind of extend this and just substitute different operations, plus, minus, multiplication, and suddenly doesn't seem so useless. So now I have actual structure around something that I could maybe run or calculate. And I've done this just by swapping out, you know, the operation here. And let's see what this tree might look like. So I wanted to use these kind of math operations and build a tree around that. So I've got like the leaves here, the literals, the literal ints, and, you know, these other operations like add, subtract, multiplication, and they just take other math expressions. You know, this is kind of like a composable tree, and this is how like math expressions work generally, just like using a calculator, you group things with parentheses, and, you know, each one's like a binary operator that takes another expression. And this is basically what this tree is. It's just a pretty basic, same kind of thing. You just have more variety, same as the other tree. But now, because you have different operations, you have more variety. You can do things with it. Does this make sense so far? I can't see anyone, so.
Yeah, it seems super applicable, like syntax trees, lots of different places have this.
Yeah, so you know, that's kind of where this is going. But, you know, so I had these binary operations, but there's no reason to have just binary operations. You can you know, add, this one's just a unary negation, but you could have any other thing. You could have even just like maybe some operation that takes a var arg list of other math objects or something. You know, you could have something else, but it's not limited to just binary operations. But I wanted to look at these two trees. And if you look, if we go back and just look at this, just swapping them out, you can see that they're virtually identical. You know, the structure is exactly the same. I just have different operations. So I want to kind of tease this out. I've got these two trees that, you know, visually I can tell that they're basically the same thing. But I want to tease out that shared structure. And so, I would just start. The first thing I always do is, instead of, you know, I had it hard-coded to int, but it always makes sense to parameterize this. I can just add a type variable. And now I can use, like, math. Maybe I could use it over numbers instead of integers. You know, in a crazy world, you might be able to do math over strings or something like that. But first step is always just to kind of, like, tease out any sort of, like, hard-coded assumptions. So this is kind of a big jump, but we can see something similar here. If you know, in that other diagram, they had the same structure, but they just had different operations. So maybe we can start by teasing out the actual operations. Maybe that will give us a structure that makes sense. So here, especially look at math. You know, I've taken out the operators and put them in their own data structure. It's all the same. Have all the same math A, all that, but it's just in a new data type. And I've just created a new variant in the math type for the operators to nest in. And I've done the same thing with tree. I've used that kind of like tupling operation or that pairing operation, and I've just put that in another data type. And so you can kind of start to see how the structure of these trees are basically the same. And here I've taken this other thing. This step here is, it doesn't really make sense for just operator to only be parameterized by math. There's, you know, I could use this in another type of syntax tree if I wanted to, just reuse the operators. So I can actually lift out math and just fix it inside of the outer tree type in either math or tree. And so I've just parameterized operator recursively, you know, with the parent here. As you can kind of see, these have the exact same structure. Leaf A, lit A, op, operator math, branch, pair, tree. So this kind of shows the shared structure of these two, and I want to lift this shared structure out now. So I'm going to call this AST. This is basically just like a generic abstract syntax tree type. And I've lifted out before I had baked in pair and operator and math and all that. And I've lifted it out to a different type variable. Oh, and I have a typo here, actually. There's tree. It says tree in there, but it should be AST. So, and now the type of my original tree is just an application of pair and int to the AST type. And likewise, my math tree is just an application of operator and int to the AST type. So now I have this shared structure, and all it takes to now implement some abstract syntax tree is just to define my operators. And this is useful. So this is just showing the transformation now of math, the original math tree, plus, minus, now the lifted out. I'm now defining it in terms of this AST type with just the operators. And it adds a little bit of structure. And so, but what makes this useful is that now we've got like a generic structure you can write, maybe just traversals around AST or something like that. You know, things that can walk in AST, but not necessarily care about what the operations are. So it may not be as, you know, it may not be as efficient. This one's actually, you can tell it's a lot less dense, or it's more dense. This one has a lot more stuff going on, a lot more pointers, but you do gain some useful things. And so you could use this, let's implement, you know, basic data type for mylang. It's going to be, we're going to parameterize AST by operation. And this operation type is maybe have like, this is, you know, basic let in an identifier. This is going to be some way to have, you know, make variable bindings, you could have a function, abstraction, and then maybe you can apply two expressions. And we're going to apply this to terms, so we can have variables or numbers. If I'm going to use this, I can now build a syntax tree for this little tiny useless program using my AST type, this branch, let in, add one. So you can kind of see how just by defining my basic, my primitives for my language, I can now actually get like a useful structure out of it by just wrapping it in this AST type.
Can I see that AST type again? I kind of got a little bit lost when we went from the normal, simple, familiar tree into abstracting it back.
So
you added this pair thing. I wasn't exactly clear the motivation for adding this extra abstraction level. Was this going towards, because you saw that there's an AST somewhere in here, so this is directing towards that?
Yeah, so looking at these two types, the point was that these share the same structure. Leaf A, lit A, op operator math, branch pair tree. So they're basically saying the same thing, but I've just used different data types in each one. So in the top one tree, the branch and op are the same thing, but instead of pair in math, I'm using operator. And likewise, instead of tree, I'm using math. And so I want to lift out this, I don't want to bake in, I want them to be able to share the same structure. So I'm going to lift out pair and operator, and I'm going to parameterize tree. I'm going to create a new data type, AST, by creating a parameter for this thing. So now I've got AST FA. So where I used to have branch F, and this was a mistake again, this inner tree that's highlighted should be AST. But where I used to have like branch pair, I've now lifted that out, abstracted it with a type variable F. And if you look below tree AST pair int, I just apply pair to the AST.
F represents each node in this tree, right? So we can pop in the type of that node.
Exactly.
Okay, I see.
So again, with math, same thing with math. Taking out the F, since I have F out of, I've generalized AST with F, now I can just pop in operator. And using the same data type that I'd already declared here. I already separate teased out operator here, and now I've got something I've teased out even more with AST. Now I can pop in operator and int, whatever my literals are. And so
I think that step is a little tricky because F is higher kinded. It's not like just a type variable, but instead.
Exactly. So F is our functor. And I'll kind of get to what this does. But yes, F is a type constructor. And so given any type constructor, if we walk back a little bit, here we made it, here we had something concrete. This is just a basic data type. Everything is baked into it, it's monomorphic. So int, and so we tease it out into a type constructor because I wanted to make things that were other than, different trees that had other kinds of data in it besides int. And so this, you can kind of liken this to like an array. So you can have arrays of strings or lists of numbers and stuff like that. And so I've just kind of, with this tree, I can have math now on different data types by parameterizing it. So that's what gives us our higher kinded type, our type constructor F. And this was just separating out the operations in our tree into a new data type. And that's what gives us the structure that looks identical. And then we can pull out that type constructor F. And now we can create our tree types based just on our operators by applying them to AST. Does that make sense?
That's very well explained. Very nice.
So this is kind of what the transformation looks like. I think I already walked over this. Yeah, so basically Okay, so I'm using this AST type, and I can make my little programming language, my abstract syntax tree, by just creating these operations and filling them into this AST type. And so that's what the tree will look like. Branch, let in, branch. So every node just has like a wrapper around it, this branch wrapper around it. Just adds this little bit of extra structure around my operator type that gives me this tree. So this AST type can take any type constructor, doesn't matter what it is, as long as it's a functor. This one we'll get to why that matters. But it can take any type constructor and turn it into a tree. So any non-recursive type constructor and turn it into a recursive tree. So this turns out to be pretty useful. But I also wanted to explore some other kind of trees. And I just, you know, I have some examples prepared, but you know, if anyone can like throw out some trees that maybe you use. I know for me, the first one that I think of are rose trees as a really useful kind of tree. And so I wanted to apply this kind of same thing to defining a rose tree of, you know, you have leaves, you have branches, and you have recursion. And so maybe I'll just start with a leaf, just like I did before on the other tree type. And then I'm going to have branch. And, you know, a rose tree is, you can have many, like in a rose tree, you'll have like a value, but then you can have like many values after it. So it's kind of like a children relationship. You know, you can have like a parent and then like many children. But this doesn't, you know, and this is kind of what it would look like if I was using Haskell list syntax. And this fits our like exact tree type that we had defined before, but it's not quite right. If we look at this, the problem is that there's no, you know, when I think of a rose tree, you know, you have to have like a parent value and then you can have children value. And this is kind of like how a DOM tree might be modeled like in the browser. You know, you'd have a node, children node. And so the branch needs a value as well. And so using this now I get this like this rose tree structure that I'm expecting where I have branch 20, then underneath that branch, I'll have more branches and they'll each have their own data type, or I mean their own values and children. But it turns out this is kind of unnecessary. So I have leaf A and branch A, but there's really no reason for me to have both leaf A and branch A because given a list, I can just define a leaf as a branch that has no children. So I can just use this single data constructor, branch A, list, rows A, you know, that this recursive tree structure. It only needs one constructor. I don't need separate leaf and branch data types. Leaves are just branches that don't have any more branches basically. And another tree type is like a binary search tree. We'll call this BST. I'll apply the same thing to it. Start out with a leaf A branch. But I know that a binary search tree, you have to have a value at each node already. At each branch, you have to have some sort of value. And you know, because that's how it, like if I was going to implement a binary search tree, you know, and I wanted to find something, well, then you have to, like, at each branch, you have to inspect, oh, if I got the value, if it's lesser than or greater than, then I take, like, the left tree or I take the right tree. And so I'm going to go ahead and add that value into the branch. So it's not quite the same as our old, like, this is kind of similar to our original just basic tree type that we formulated at the beginning. But I've just added this extra, I've tagged the branch with a value as well. So this is kind of what it would look like. And there's actually a problem with this definition of it. And the main problem is that because everything must have a value, both the leaf and the branches must have a value, you could actually only implement like a tree with an odd number of items in it. You know, so that you can't even have like an even tree. But so to do that, I need to express, okay, maybe a tree might have a child or it might not. And so we'll just substitute nothing instead of leaf. And that gives us our tree type that we can kind of, you can either go down if there's more children, keep going, or you can, you know, just stop, there'll be nothing. And so I can kind of tease out this structure again. I don't really need nothing because I can just say, oh, a branch, there might be children or there might not be. So I'll just pull that out into maybe. And I don't even think I really have to change anything with the inner ones. They still say it's nothing. but everything just ends up having this just structure around it. I can tease that out further, just like how in the original tree I'd separate it out into pair. I had two things, and I can turn them into one kind of wrapper by wrapping it in pair, so I don't have to like duplicate the definition. And this is just inserting the pairs. So we have these two definitions of trees that are, I hope you can kind of see that they basically follow the same structure as well, but this is not the same structure. This is not the same AST structure that we were using before. This is, it's a little bit simpler in a way, just because it's one constructor, but you can see that there's a value. And seeing how these are similar, sorry, excuse me, one second. If you look at these in rows, branch A, list rows A, it's kind of similar to in BST, the branch A, but I just have more structure in binary search tree. So I want to try to make these, try to tease these into a form that's basically the similar, as close to each other as possible. So in rows tree, I only have one level underneath it. I just have list. I have this one list data type, this functor type under here. And in binary search tree, I actually have two. I have pair and maybe nested in each other. So I want to see if there's a way that I can turn pair maybe into a single functor instead of two levels of nesting. And one way to do that would be to just create a new data type. I can obviously just separate this out into its own data type and make a functor instance of it. But there's actually, I kind of wanted to throw this in there just because it's kind of neat, a neat way to see how these can combine together. And I wanted to look at function composition here. So given, I think most people are fairly familiar with function composition, the application of G of A to F is identical to the application of A to F and G composed. So function composition is the same, actually, it turns out is the same as functor composition. So given two data types, two functors like array or list, two type constructors that are nested, you can turn them, you can compose them just like you would compose functions by wrapping them in some data type compose f of g. And what this is basically saying that function composition, the composition of two functions, is also a function. And it's the same thing with functor composition. The composition of two functors is also a functor. So functors behave very similar to functions in this way. And I can take this two levels of nesting and collapse it down into a single functor using functor composition. And this is what this data type is. And it's not super important, but you can kind of see the structure of compose FG, two type constructors, F and G. They're just nested inside each other. And this is just a new type, F and G. This represents nested functors. And I can turn it into a single level of, it's a single type constructor by using compose. So pair maybe, this nested type of pair maybe, can turn into a single layer using compose pair maybe A. And so I, you know, this is a little heavier, but I hope it can kind of make sense. Like, and if I take this type, branch A, pair maybe, I can turn it into something that has the same structure. So these end up having the same structure by applying composition. Rows, branch A, list rows as the same constructor or same structure as branch A, compose pair maybe. And so if I separate this out in the same way I did with the original AST type, here I have list baked in and I have compose pair maybe baked in. I can lift that out, lift out that type constructor into F here. So now I've got this tree type annotated FA. And I've just lifted out the functor, made it a type argument. And so now rows can be implemented using this generic tree type, just applying list in A to annotated, and likewise binary search tree is the same as applying compose pair maybe to annotated. And you can do other things like, you know, this functor thing is actually pretty cool because you can just like start substituting in functors and just kind of see what you get out of it. And so things that weren't trees before, like this example of like a string map, things that weren't trees, by just substituting it and adding this extra structure around it, this annotated structure, I can turn string map into a lookup trie, which is a pretty neat, I thought was a pretty neat trick. So I just want to generate some trie. There's this function, and it turns, you know, this associations of keys and values, and I want to turn it into a lookup trie. I apply this structure, and we're going to pretend that whatever language I'm using in has, you know, object or, you know, str map literal syntax. And that can turn this into this tree structure where you start with an annotation. I think I left out something, but this lookup trie should be maybe, I'm using it with maybe int. So this of the value. So this we're going to start with the annotation structure or the an constructor. Not going to have anything at the root, but I'm going to have f in, or foo inserted into it, and it's going to have the one value. It's not going to have any more children, but then you might have, you tease out the different, like the shared components of the inner values. So like b, so it actually, I think, would be ba, but then it would have r and z, and they would have those types. So by applying just this string map with this annotated, this extra annotated tree type, I can turn just a basic functor string map into something that's totally different, something that's totally that's reusable for something completely different. And there's other things that you could substitute into that. Like we already said that, like list, this annotated list is like a rows tree, and you know, the same thing with like array, it would just be like a different basic, like a different thing like that. But you know, if you substituted something like identity, then you would just get like an infinite list, which is kind of neat. And if you just substitute maybe as the functor, you could get like a non-empty list. So this, you know, there's all these sorts of things. Just by substituting in different functors, you can get these different tree types. And just playing, and I think it's kind of fun. One day I just kind of sat down and just like tried different ones and just tried expanding out the structure and seeing what I could get out of them. And so we've got these two tree types that we've talked about. This AST type, that gave us basically a totally generic way of building abstract syntax trees. We could substitute by choosing a different functor for our operations. We could get like a totally different kind of tree. And the same with this annotated data type. It's just slightly different, but we get a different, you know, different kind of tree. But these turn out to be related, because if you look at AST, it's a sum type where you have a value or a branch of some type. Look at that again, you have the leaf and the branch. And then if you take the annotated, it's a value and a branch. So these two things are duals to each other. Go back and see this annotated. It's a product type here, an with some value, A, and then branching under F. And these two types, this AST type, is what we call free. And this annotated type that we used is called cofree.
I have a quick question. I'm wondering why you chose the word annotated to describe that data structure just now.
So I chose annotated just because I couldn't think of anything better. you know, if you look at like the definitions, you know, it just uses cofree. And I think like in the Haskell one too, it just uses like, it actually uses a type operator. So it doesn't actually really have a name. So, you know, but we can use it as a way of having, if you think of like the F as the branching, then every branch is annotated with a value of A. So I call it, it's an annotated tree. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's cool.
So it's kind of, you know, so what? So we got this free type. This is like our AST type. Okay, so I can build ASTs, that's great. Okay, whatever. I mean, that's kind of useful on its own, right? You know, because like if I was like implementing a toy programming language, like I said, you know, we have general things. I like to, whenever I hear the word generic, I want to substitute it with reusable. So when things are generic, that means that I can write more reusable things around them. So by having this generic tree data type, I can write these operations that work on just this tree data type. But then when I substitute in other things for the type variables, I get to use all the same functions again, just in a different way over a different data type. So that's, you know, kind of, so that's useful in its own right. But there's also another, there's something cool about this, about these two things. that if you look at, if you start implementing instances for these things, and the implementation isn't actually important for this talk. I mean, you know, I just put them up here just to kind of, I just want to look through as we start implementing them, like what we kind of see is the same between all of them. Functor free, apply free. This is, you know, these are the correct definitions for this, but, you know, but apply, applicative, bind, and monad. So, you know, what is the same between all of these? I hope it's a little apparent by my formatting, but they all have only have a functor constraint. See that, a functor f in the instance. So that means with this free type, if I can provide a functor, that's all I need, just to provide a functor and wrap it in free, then I can get a monad out of it. And we use monads for all sorts of things. Like, you know, most of our, if you've used do notation with f to do anything, you know, you've used monads. So, I mean, you know, monads are used everywhere. And this is basically just like a really cheap way of getting one, because all I have to do is write functor. And if I wrap it in free, then I get all the monad stuff for it automatically based on this data type. And it's the same thing with Cofree. If I can provide a functor, I can go up the dual hierarchy of extend and comonad. And I'm not going to touch too much on comonads. I think actually Phil has some cool stuff on that that might be, you know, that kind of might extend this talk a little bit. But with Cofree, it's the same thing. I can provide a functor. If I just wrap it in Cofree, then I get a comonad out of it automatically. Law-abiding comonad, same with monad. So show me the monads. I kind of wanted to look at, okay, so maybe doing some live coding here, seeing what we can build out of this. And I just wanted to build, you know, with monads, that's like one of the most useful things is that you get to use do syntax, right? You know, you get to write like these little clean imperative programs within this functional language. And so, you know, having a monad is really useful. You can do all sorts of stuff with it. But I wanted to kind of go through of writing some ideal little program and how we can build basically our AST around it. And I just kind of, so let's just, it's just going to do like basic, you know, this is the example that's pretty much always used, is that you have some sort of input and output. So I just want to do like, hello, this program is going to say hello, and it's going to speak, you know, what is, and then it might, you know, we do this a lot. We're gonna wait on input. So, you know, if you've ever used, you know, try to connect to a database or something like that, you'll have like this bind syntax. So it's useful maybe even to listen, and then we can speak. So, name. So I've got a program, and that's actually like, you know, when you think about like monad, so if with just our AST type and the AST type that we built, it was a fairly static tree structure. And, but you know, when you implement a monad, it's no longer just a static tree of like representing a program or something. You can actually have dynamic components to it. And you can see how I'm using this monad, or like the syntax that we have for monads, I've built something that's actually quite dynamic. You know, the speak is static here, you know, speak. All right, can everyone see this, or do I need to zoom in some more?
Looks okay from here.
Yep.
I can zoom in some more if you want. You know, it's a little, just a little bit bigger. But, you know, so I've got this program. The speak is static here. But as soon as we get to listen, I now have like a completely dynamic portion of my program where everything after it can depend on whatever the value of name is. So it's no longer a static tree. It's a tree that can morph depending upon whatever it gets out of listen. I don't know. We haven't implemented this yet, but it's interesting. You know, it's an interesting aspect of why this is different than just an AST and what using like a monad instance gives you. So I just want to like try modeling this data type, and I'm going to start in the same way. We'll call this maybe talker. And kind of start with our monomorphic tree type that we used before, but I'm going to represent every operation within this as a data type. So I've got this speak, hello, what is your name? And then I've also got listen, but I'm going to start with just speak. So the first thing that speak does is that it needs a string. If I'm going to speak, I need to model it with, you know, with whatever this data type is that I'm using. And I can actually, now if I but this doesn't, this just stops. So if I wrote a program, I'm going to call this talker. All I can write is speak hello. But I want to represent, you know, a sequence of actions here. So maybe I could maybe do like array or something, but, you know, I started doing this, then I can start doing, you know, speak, what is your name? Let me get the indentation right. But once I get to this listen, I'm kind of blocked because, say I'm just gonna like fill it in. I don't know what it is, but this next one after it is gonna be speak, nice to meet you. And somehow, you know, it's gotta depend on whatever this one had in it. So I can't quite model it as just a static list here because I've got part of the sequence of actions that depends on the previous sequence of actions. So I'm gonna take out this array and maybe I'm just gonna start by modeling it just totally within the talker type. All I want is talker. So if I wanted to have like a sequence of these, I might take maybe list as an example. You would have nil, and then you'd have cons, and then you'd have the next list, next item in the list. So that kind of gives me my sequence here. Instead of list, I'm gonna maybe do speak. Next one can be a talker. So this actually lets me speak, you know, hello. And then speak, what is your, oops. But now, but this goes on for forever. You see, I've string talker. This would, there's no way for me to terminate this. So I can just add done. And now I've got this basic program. I'm gonna comment this out just because I want to start compiling things now. And that's not, I can't compile that yet. So now if I've got this basic program here, it's just a sequence of a couple of speaks. And let's do run program. And this is gonna go from talker. I want to interpret this into like actual, like I want to log to something. So I'm just gonna do, I'm gonna write something that can look at this tree and actually do something with it. So let's do go program. And I'm going to pattern match on this. So I've got speak, I've got my string in there, and I've got my next talker item in there. And I can do, now I can do log string. And I can stop there, like if I can compile this actually, so main. Run this program. Oh, got a type error. This is always a problem. Could not match type F with function. What am I missing?
Fail put go program to go.
Well, this is, that's the, gosh.
Run program's type is a function, but you're passing the program into it there.
Oh, right. There you go. Yeah, good. So let's take out that talker. We don't need that because I've already provided it. Another type error. Oh, I'm just missing a case. So it's telling me I'm just missing my done case. So I can't do anything with this except, you know, stop. I told it I'm returning unit, so I'm going to just give it a unit. But wait, I run this, it just says hello here. So, I've done a couple things. So I need to do something with next here. So I can just run and go again. Recursive, I'm writing a recursive tree here. So I'm just gonna write a recursive function over this next. And now when I compile it, I get hello, and what is your name? So I've got this basic data type now, a very, very simple program that doesn't do much. And I've got a basic interpreter that can take those actions, this very, very simple list-like tree, and actually make a program out of it that does something. So let's try to tackle this listen. So if we look at, just collapse these, and kind of ignores these. These are just our tree from the talk and the instances. If you look at listen, it's getting something like, well, you know, what is it doing? It's waiting. So, you know, theoretically it would be like waiting for someone to like give it something. So listen, going to wait for someone to respond with a name so that I can then finish this tree with whatever it provides me. So the way we might express this dependency now is, instead of just having like a straight talker, I have now, as a dynamic component, I can bundle in a function of string to talker. So this means, this listen data type means that, okay, this action, it's going to have a function in it, and when you give that function a string, it can give you the rest of the talker program. And so I can model this now, listen name. And it'll speak. Nice to meet you. Name. Actually, I have to add something to speaker. If I try to compile this, I'll get a type error. I haven't terminated the program because speaker takes another argument. If I run this, I'll get could not match type talker with talker. It's because speak expects another argument. We'll just add another done here. If I compile this, I'm missing a case, listen. Well, now we've got to add another thing to our interpreter for listen. I'm going to take out this function. And and the only thing I can do with this to continue is to give it a string. So I don't have any strings on hand, so I'll just give it, you know, one. So Clarence. And that'll give me a talker. So I'll have to run it with go again. This is it's giving me the rest of the tree. So now when I run this, list. Oops. When I run this, I now get this program active. Hello, what is your name? Nice to meet you, Clarence. So I've just provided this out of nowhere, but you know, I can actually take, maybe I'll parameterize this program here. Okay, name. I can reply with. And when I run program with Bob, I'll get nice to meet you, Bob. Likewise, if maybe Jenny. Every time I run this program now, I've created an abstract program here that can depend on some input that we don't know about. And I can write an interpreter that walks that structure and can provide it the values it needs out of the environment. So let's take that, and with this free type, this has, you know, this is actually, this works pretty well. But you know, I can make this kind of reusable, and I want to use it with my tree type, this free type. And the first thing that we did when kind of abstracting was to just take out the recursion. So maybe, you know, when we abstracted out those operations, I want to make this work with free. I'm going to take out the operations, the recursion, like that. So I can define talker now in terms of free with using free talker f. So now, okay, let's see. So now talker is no longer...
You probably want to take the A off both sides there.
Why?
Because you won't be able to, well, it depends, but you won't be able to partially apply it if you need to for the, if you do it with a natural transformation or whatever later. I don't know what you're going to show here. But.
Well, I'm not going to quite get there, but I left it on there just to show because I find like the partial kind of confusing.
Yeah.
We know that there's another...
You don't need it, it doesn't matter, but yeah.
Yeah, we know there's another variable, so you can actually leave those off and just apply it like that. But we know there's another variable, so I'm going to leave that in because it's confusing otherwise. So now talker is no longer monomorphic over the talker tree. It's now parameterized by some A as well. So I gotta pull an A out of somewhere. So for all, we'll just go ahead and, maybe for all A is not the best thing. We'll just go ahead and say unit, because our program was unit. We ended with unit, just terminated. So we'll just say talker is gonna end with unit. You know, that's the only thing that kind of makes sense in this case for this program. But let's go ahead and start wrapping it. It's maybe the tree structure. So remember the branch, wherever we have a branch, this A, we're going to use the role data type. And wherever we have a value, which in our case was only unit, program only ends with unit, we're going to have pure. So we can say role, speak hello. Now we're starting to kind of look like, it kind of looks like a little program now. Starting to kind of mirror. Our little program we wrote. For now I'm going to say, well, leave done. I needed that before, but I don't think I really need that anymore because I can just use pure unit. I can remove this because I just needed a way to terminate it. When I had done before, I just needed it because I needed a way to terminate my program. Otherwise my program would be infinite, but with the extra free structure around it, I have a way to terminate it with pure. And so let's look at this. This actually looks, it's starting to look quite a bit like this little program here, program speak. I've kind of used the dollar sign to kind of eliminate some of the nesting. But, you know, we could just keep applying these, like, parentheses like we did before. But, you know, when using the dollar sign here, you kind of see that it's starting to look like a little program. So let's just interpret it now. We've got to add this structure around it. Go program. We're just going to have to pattern match. We built it with role, so we got to pattern match on role. That's all we got to do. We don't actually have done anymore, but we do have pure. It's going to have some value in it. So I can just do this. You can see it still compiles. Now, yay, Jenny. Let's change it again to Jared. All right, so it still works. That's cool. So what does this give us? You know, we've just wrapped it in this tree, but we know that given just a functor, a type constructor, this free also gives us a monad instance for it, which should let us write this little program the way we want it to, this clean kind of syntax. I don't know about you, but I don't really want to write my programs with dollar signs everywhere like that. But, and one thing that's nice also about new compiler stuff is that I don't even actually have to write this instance. I can just derive instance and get it. I get it really for free here. And this is, and I need this because all of these instances rely on F being a functor here. You can see in these instances. So now how, let's start like building this out. Now I want to start turning this into this program here. You know what I'm going to do? I'm actually going to take this. I'm going to put it below here. And this is going to be our goal. Oops. The same thing, I can't compile right now, but This is going to be our goal. So I want to turn this role speak hello into just a speak. So I got to take out, this is going to be a function. So this function is going to take a string. And it's got to return a talker of some type. In our representation here, it has to also take another talker. That's just an argument. So string given another talker, some type A. It can return a talker of type A. So this kind of works, but that just means I'm kind of teasing it out now a little. So I've got my string and I've got my next, and I can bundle this up into role speak string next. And same with listen. I got to take my function string to talker A. It's going to give me a talker A. Listen. And then done. Let's go ahead and add this talker unit. So now I can kind of start taking this out. I can just write this. This is a lot nicer. Still not quite there, but it's a lot nicer. Yeah. We're getting there. Comment this out.
Pure uni?
Oh, you. Okay, so it still works. We're getting there. We've moved some of the structure, or at least some of the boilerplate. We define these little functions that just does it for us, but I want to get to this. So speak hello, I'm writing this within do syntax. And as far as I know, do syntax is not the same as function applications. So, I guess you may be able to write something that works over that. You know, some crazy little weird instance. But I need to be able to model this so that speak doesn't actually take another argument. I want to start writing with do. And in my do block, speak only takes one argument. It doesn't take a talker A. So if I'm given a string, what would be the type of this? I mean, if speak is a program in and of itself, a talker program in and of itself, it has to end. And so really the only thing it can end with is unit. That'd be like writing in our original one, that'd be like writing speak, hello, done. It'd be like writing that. But I'm not quite sure what I should fill that in with yet. Same way with listen. I know I'm going to take a string. Actually, listen in and of itself, if we look at our little syntax here, listen doesn't take anything. Listen's just a plain, it's just a program, just a talker program. But it does yield a string. So that is a little more interesting. So it doesn't take any arguments, but it will yield a string. And take out this argument, but I'm not sure what I'm gonna put there yet. And this done is the same, so I can take that out, I can leave that there for now. But let's go back. I want to kind of see what I should fill in here. Hopefully it'll still tell me. A, whole A has inferred type free, talker F unit. In the following context. So all I've got is a string. It's not telling me too much. It's interesting. But if it has to be a talker unit, I do have a done, which is a talker unit. So I can just do this. That should work. I should type check. Okay, so that type checks. Let's go to the next one. Listen. Whole B has the inferred type string to free talker F string. You could substitute the whole with one of these values, pure. So it's actually giving me something that I can use. So let's go ahead and use what it tells me to use. And this should actually type check now. Maybe let's try taking this out and using this program now. Hey, it works. All right. So now I've defined these, and it's kind of magic, right? So I've defined these programs that terminate, speak terminates itself. You know, I mean, it doesn't keep going. It doesn't take another talker. It just ends with done. And likewise, talker listen just has, just is just using pure. I don't really know why, but I just substituted in what, you know, what PureScript told me to do. So it works. And I can actually, because it's talker unit, and I know speak is talker unit, I don't actually need this extra done. It's kind of redundant. Because speak is already talker unit, still works. I can still provide, you know, different names that work. So, and the reason why this works is because I've got all this monad stuff for free from this data type. And whenever you bind, do a syntax sugar for bind, it traverses all the way down the leaves of whatever tree you're using, and it substitutes in the next thing automatically for you. So whereas before we were building up this tree manually through function application, the monad instance kind of does this magic for us, and it can take a program that we've given it, and it can string it together another program after it by walking the tree structure automatically. Doesn't matter what you use, what functor you use, it knows how to walk the tree structure, and it can stitch these programs together for you automatically. So that's why it's so helpful. Instead of just writing maybe our own monomorphic instance. And you can actually do that too. You know, I could go back to Talker, like the plain one, the plain monomorphic one, and I could, you know, I could probably figure out how to make a monad instance out of it in and of itself. But, you know, this is kind of cool. I've built this little program, and I could actually, you know, I've done it, parameterized it with name, but, you know, I could do something else. I could maybe, I don't have random installed, but I could do maybe import control.monad.random. Maybe we'll do random int. Or
dot f dot random.
Oh, yeah. Dot random. Let's do bower install. Is it just random? Ta-da! Okay.
Install. I've got one. Can I ask something? Well, how would you do it with, say, like a string in or something like that? So, you know, when you require a name.
Yeah, CRN. So I would have to provide more in the environment. You know, so I could, so I'm writing it in F. You know, I could, if the problem is that I'm in JavaScript, so I could actually write it in AF. I think there might be an AF wrapper.
I think there is. I was looking at it yesterday.
Around like console input where you can like wait on it. But I finished this about like 10 minutes before.
Cool.
You know, so I didn't have time for it, but you know, I'm just trying this because it's the first thing I thought of. So maybe I'll just do like in, you know, and we can do random, and I can reply with whatever name I give it, and I can append, you know, whatever random in I pulled out of my backside here. So all right. It works. Yeah, nice to meet you. 0.3, whatever. You know, so this whole program is now depends on just some random value. But you know, this is the idea of taking a basic data type, just a functor, and it's cool because PureScript gives us this functor for, you know, it'll just drive it for us, and by plugging it into this free data type, I can now write programs. But then it's not just, you know, if you've ever written a real program, I mean, like, you know, you write any trivial program, if you're just writing an F, it's kind of opaque. All the actions are totally, completely opaque. You can't do anything with them. You know, I mean, you can string them together, but you can't inspect what each one actually is because it really is just a runtime blob of code. But if you kind of, instead of thinking about just stringing together Fs, you know, I can maybe just write something like this, maybe write a functor that does just what I need it to. This functor only does speak and listen. I've modeled it as data. So when I model it as data, that means that I can write an interpreter that does whatever I want with that data. And so this interpreter is really simple. It just pulls out, you know, it logs whatever the person speaks, but maybe I could actually run like the speak command, or what does it say? I don't remember.
DFD.
Yeah, say. I could have it actually like say stuff like that. I could actually have it whenever I ask for the age or for their name, I could maybe, so say I'm listening, I get, it asks for some value. I could like pull something out of a database, I could write, And so I now I have like some flexibility in my program, where here I'm only modeling it with just pure values of like Larry that I provide up front. That might be useful for like a development environment just to test my program. But I could write in a separate interpreter for a production that actually pulls things out of the database. So now
maybe it'd be worth showing this as a kind of fault-free version of the interpreter so that you don't have to include just the role and pure structure. So you can just provide the...
Right. And so, I don't have that prepared. I kind of wanted to show, all the guts.
Well, you could probably write it in here pretty quick because it's just a case of extracting out stuff.
You could actually do, run program. I could do is, using the free library in PureScript, it would be like fault-free go program. And this go wouldn't even actually have like the role structure. It would be folding over just the functor. So you don't even actually have to deal with all this kind of stuff, which is pretty nice. You wouldn't need that. I wouldn't need the recursion. The fold would take care of the recursion for me. So, I would just have to yield the next value in here. And same with apply, it would end up being like this, or no go, just pure. And so now my interpreter would get a lot simpler by using just the fold free stuff. And, I've implemented it here with this free structure. And you could, the actual PureScript free stuff has a bunch of other utilities. And that's kind of the idea is that, while I had written this simple naive interpreter that actually pattern matches on everything, the fold free stuff can take care of it all generically for me. And it gives me lots of utilities to just turn it into a very, very simple interpretation where I don't even have to look at the tree structure or the free structure. I just look at what's in my data type. And so that's kind of like the power of what this like free, this idea of free and free monads gives us. And, I kind of hope that it makes sense that it's not just all about getting like the monad stuff, while that's useful. It's that this structure exists as something else entirely as well, as just like this tree. It's just a way of building generic trees. But it does turn out that you can write a monad instance for this tree, which gives us all this kind of cool dynamic, flexibility for writing programs. So that was the demo. And so like, what about comonads? I don't have time to like talk about comonads, but I had kind of likened it to annotating a tree. So you could actually, so if free is like your way of building an AST, well, then a comonad would be kind of like a way of annotating that tree. So whereas an AST would just have our syntax, if I wrapped it again with a comonad, it would be like annotating it with, position information or types or something like that. So like that I could use in the type checker. So that's one way of thinking about comonad or thinking about cofree. But also if you think about monads as representing programs, monads represent programs. What do we do with this program that we wrote? So we wrote this basic program using the monad machinery, the free monad machinery. But what's the dual of building a program? Cofree is the dual of free. If I built a program with free, what can I build with Cofree? And Cofree, you can build interpreters. And so if monads represent programs, then comonads represent, it's a question mark, but comonads can represent the interpreters of those programs. But that's where I'm going to leave it. There's a cool article, Free for DSLs, Cofree for Interpreters. And I think, Phil has a lot more to say about this in the context of user interfaces. I know he's kind of wanted to talk about that. So I might, I'm, I'm going to leave this for someone else. Maybe if someone wants to read further on this, this is kind of an interesting subject, but you know, maybe Phil has more to say on that as well. But I hope that makes sense. I hope that kind of helps. You know, for me at least, I know it helped, you know, quite a bit in understanding what those are. But
yeah, that's super clear. Thank you.
Yeah, I thought that was amazing.
That was a great presentation. Thank you.
So it's like anytime you want to build a data structure, Free can really do it because.
Yeah, and so, well, both and either one, you have different, use them for different circumstances, you know, for some kind of trees you might use Free, and but yeah, you can build up anything. All you need is a functor, which is, if the functor is totally non-recursive, it's just like a basic data type, and but as soon as you wrap it in Free, it turns it into this kind of nested structure, which is pretty cool, I think. And the same with Cofree, it's just a different kind of tree, and so these are both kind of primitive tree types, and they just happen to be duals of each other. And so where you'd use one in one instance, well, maybe it may not be right. Well, then you just might use the other one, and you can build something out of it. So
there's something they both have in common. There's like it's a slightly more primitive version of either, which is usually called mu. Yeah. And it's basically the kind of recursive part without the annotation or the kind of equivalent of pure. So when you kind of stack all these things together, you can kind of this is what all kind of, like, if you've heard of recursion schemes, this is mainly what they're about, is sort of using these different representations to deal with recursive data structures in a generic way. So you can kind of abstract out some of the stuff. Oh, yeah, Nathan's going to write a mu for us here.
Yeah, mu, so where I had this Free, it takes any functor. So maybe I just do like list or something, you know, it takes any functor and turns it into this tree. But if I take out even this pure part, just eliminate that, and just have kind of the, actually, you know, I call this null.
It's called quite often.
Yeah.
We can call this fix. Why don't we call this fix?
It's well, it's technically not fixed, but yeah, okay.
I don't really know. This is kind of like, I haven't really gotten to this part, so.
You've got this least and greatest fixed point of the functor, yeah. So you can have it either way. Anyway, yeah.
But, you know, fix FA. So it's the same thing. This can take, now, instead of turning it into a tree, it just turns any non-recursive data type into a recursive data type. So fix list is now.
You could show Cofree as well, because that's like, that's got the product, which also contains role in it essentially, but without the, yeah.
Yeah. So like list. So this fix type would turn a non-recursive list into a recursive list. So that's kind of, that's just another aspect of like, kind of like even pulling out this kind of structure even more. And, what's the Cofree one? I don't even know what would it.
Well, Cofree is just got an A in there, but it's the same apart from that.
So. Okay, Cofree, yeah, let's do, I'll just call it Cofree. It would have A, Cofree, or F, sorry. So that's our Cofree type, and so what's the other one? This one's gonna be mu, right? What would it be? I don't even know what it is.
Oh, new, you mean? That one is different. Yeah, Cofree and Free both share the same actual structure. Like the recursive part is the same. It's mu in both cases.
Oh, okay.
New is the other one where you haven't, you know, codata and whatever else. I mean, yeah. I'm slightly less familiar with that as well.
Yeah, I haven't dealt much with fixed point data types. So I still have learning to do on that aspect, on that front. But I hope that made sense at least. Any questions, any comments, or anything else? Otherwise, we can either take a break or we can move on to the next talk.
That's super good from my end. Enjoyed that.
Do you know any situations where you'd, a data structure that you want to make, but Free or Cofree wouldn't be the right choice?
You can probably tease that. Like I said, since it's just a generic tree, it's just like the bare minimum to make something in a tree. You can probably actually like tease out any recursive data type into one of these things. And that's actually, if there's a that's just kind of like what it's like. That gets into kind of like the fixed point stuff we were talking about just now, and called recursion schemes and all that kind of stuff. And so you can model all these kind of recursive data types just using these core primitives. And it may not be ideal. Like, you know, definitely adds overhead, as we kind of saw in the expansions of this. Like, if you were actually like build these things manually, you can see they add a lot of indirection. And so in certain cases, it may not be worth it. Like, you know, like in the compiler, like in the PureScript compiler, you know, you can model the AST as, you know, something based off of free, but it's probably not worth it. So, you know, it's just, you know, the recursion is baked in, it's simpler, it's faster. And it's kind of the same thing. Well, then you can annotate the syntax tree with Cofree, but that may not be ideal, but it's definitely useful. At least you get a lot of stuff for the trade-off is that it may be more overhead, but as with all generic things, you have more reusable components available to you. So whereas we may have had to write all these traversals by hand to walk over the tree, when we use these kind of generic spines, then all that functionality can be written once and be reused everywhere. It's kind of like with type classes. You know, type classes are great because they allow you to write functions that work over constraints, and you just write them once and you can apply them to anything that implements that type class. So it's kind of it's a similar idea.
Where was the overhead and free? Because it looks like this very essential data structure. I didn't see anything.
The overhead, I gotta find the expansion of free in our AST. So if you look at the original math AST, by overhead, I just mean basically it's pointer overhead. So this is our original one. When we do it with free, you just have this extra wrapping around each node. So you just have more objects. It takes up more memory. It, you know, you have more pointers to follow. And so that's kind of basically what I mean by overhead.
I see.
But you know, it's a generic spine. I get lots of operations for free. I can do lots of cool stuff on it, you know, just off of that by providing like the minimal specification. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So did you end up like using free for, because it looks like it'd be really good for DOM manipulation and stuff like that. Is that where?
Well, you know, I can't quite use it for DOM. I mean, you can. We use it in SLAM data. We use it everywhere. So basically, our entire program, all of our business logic runs through something like this. So instead of making, you know, requests to our API just through baked-in AFs or Fs, you know, we have just like we model the requests with data types. And then we can lift it into our core program data type, this kind of this free data type, and then we can provide an interpreter at the very root of our program that does stuff with it. So you could imagine, by modeling it with pure data, I could run tests that don't ever make actual API requests. If I was using AF, I would have to make those requests always. But because I lift it into a data type and I interpret it, I can interpret it in different contexts. So that for testing, I might just stub in data, and then in production, it might actually make the requests. And, or for example, you could write an interpreter, like if you wrote an interpreter over HTTP requests, you could write one that automatically caches data. So that tends to be like a caching, you know, caching tends to be a problem in, you know, web apps. You know, sometimes I don't always want to make this request. Well, I can write my program as if I'm getting it every single time, but I could supply an interpreter that caches it. So, you know, to the program, to the author, it looks like I don't have to worry about caching. But then I could dynamically, in the context, substitute in some sort of caching mechanism. So that's like another use case for it. So we use it all the time for pretty much everything at SLAM Data, you know. And so it's very, very, very useful for writing programs.
Yeah, I could see definitely a benefit for tests. Because the other day I was just trying to stub out some API calls, and obviously in JavaScript, you've just got to create a virtual server, do you know what I mean, to mimic everything coming in and out, and it's such a pain in the ass. But yeah,
so it's kind of a you don't really want to say it, but you know, it's like basically like dependency injection, in that I can write my program based on a dependency, which isn't provided until runtime via an interpreter. So that's kind of a way of modeling it in a functional programming language like PureScript, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, that's cool.
But like the dependency injection is strictly less powerful, right? Because the dependency injection is just like when you create your own type class, but with free you actually get to inspect the program as a structure.
Yeah, and that's also what makes it cool, is that's why it's different than just implementing type classes. And so we implement things as free, and we wrap it in a new type, and we give it all the instances, so it looks like it's just like just an opaque data type. But because we've implemented it with free, we can run it, and you can do dynamic stuff on it that you wouldn't normally, you may not necessarily be able to do by just, you know, writing these concrete types like with the type class instances. So the free stuff gives you this kind of dynamic flexibility, and it's really, really cool. So you can like kind of introspect it as you run it and make decisions on what you do or how you fetch things or how you provide, you know, when it requests something from the environment, how you provide that, it can change depending on your program and how your program evolves, which is really cool.
Yeah, you really get things for free.
Well, mostly. And what's actually really cool too is with the PureScript implementation, it's really fancy. And so the data types provided in the talk are what would be considered the naive implementations. And it's just naive because they're not very performant. They're really, really simple, but they have some performance issues. Because, like, you know, I mentioned that with the monad, the free monad stuff, every time you do a bind, it has to traverse the entire tree to get to the leaves to substitute the next action. And so you can kind of imagine in certain cases, it's kind of like with a list, when you append, as long as you're appending to the front of a list or consing to the front of the list, it's fast. It's just a single allocation. But as soon as you want to append to the end of a list, then you have to traverse the entire list structure just to get to the end. So you have to build the entire list again just to make that substitution. And so the implementation in PureScript free, if you think of list as one data structure, well, I might use something that's more efficient, like an array provides like random access or something, you know. So I can access any offset in constant time. And so, well, if I'm kind of have this list structure with free where I have to traverse the leaves, well, maybe I can like box it up in the same way. So instead of using this list structure, I'm using a better data type to represent these binds. And so that's kind of what PureScript free does. And so it's more complicated. It's a more dense implementation, but it's more performant because it doesn't have like the list like performance issues where if you're going to append to the list, then you have to traverse the whole list. So it just kind of lets you append it at either end. So it makes it a faster, more performant implementation.
Yeah, because you can start composing them and things
in the straight out. So it's just more complicated. It's the same idea, but it's just a more complicated implementation for the purposes of efficiency. And it's same with the Cofree implementation. The Cofree data type actually kind of assumes laziness because usually you kind of want, lots of times you want these trees to be, especially when you're writing, using them as interpreters, you want them to be actually infinite. And in a strict language that doesn't work. So it's actually the Cofree structure kind of depends on laziness. And so the actual implementation in PureScript has a lazy wrapper around it. So
yeah, that's the equivalent of new. You were talking earlier about, you know, what would this one look like? It's the same, but we just need to throw a lazy in there. So
yeah.
So, cool. Thanks.
All right. So if there's nothing else, do you guys want to take a break or do you want to just move on?
I don't mind powering through.
I heard some other people are saying they were going to take a break. I'm not sure if they need a few more minutes or not.
All right. Well, we can wait a few minutes. Let's see, that was quite a long talk. So, you know, what, like an hour and 20 minutes. So with all the discussion, so I can kind of just power through the virtual DOM one when everyone gets back.
Yeah. Should we come back in like three to 5 minutes?
Yeah. Sounds good.
Cool.
maybe while we're in the break, could I ask a question? So in the talk, you asked about different kinds of trees, right, that we could imagine or we know.
Yeah.
And then you showed rose trees and binary trees, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And then I thought of KD trees because I did these, or needed these for something relatively, well, sometime. And I thought about it, and does that still work? Because then I think you need something different in the leaves and in the branches. Or you need to be able to supply like a different comparison function in the branches.
Mm-hmm.
And basically like the, like you have one level, like then you have like three different branching like dimensions. So is that?
I don't know. I don't actually know what they are, so.
Oh, the you can use them to do nearest neighbor thingies in like in 2D things or matching colors, just like 3D spaces. But you have like the nodes are one level is the like X coordinate, the next level is the Y coordinate, and then you get back to X and Y and X and Y. So you like you interleave these different kinds of nodes.
Mm-hmm.
Idea.
So I think maybe if you, as you like go to express more invariants in your tree, like say like if you had like a, maybe if you added like another data type that fixes, you know, maybe like the size of the tree or something or the depth of the tree, like you want to make that type safe, like the gadgets or something, you know, it may be harder to do that, like tease it out. I'm not sure. I don't really, you know, it's still a little over my head and stuff like that. So, you know, this is kind of what I understand so far.
Yeah, it's a bit like the type of node depends on the modulo of the height that you're at.
Right. So maybe then, you know, it's kind of like how we substituted that function into it. You know, maybe there's something there where you have to provide something and like it, that's what determines the next level of the tree. I don't know. You know, something like that. I don't know. I don't know if I'm quite smart enough to figure that out yet. Have to think about it.
Yeah, might be something there. I'm not sure.
Yeah, free is only useful for data structures which are recursive, using the same kind of data in each branch, right? Because like I was kind of write a bunch of types so I can generate SQL. SQL strings, and
you can do some extra stuff on at the functor layer to get around that. So you can use a co-product of two different functors, which means essentially you can switch between two structures. But that's two structures at arbitrary points. If you need something where you have two sort of embedded, slightly different structures, then it does get a bit more, you know, complicated, or doesn't exactly. But
right.
Yeah, I mean,
you don't really have just a recursive data type, you end up with something that's kind of mutually recursive, I think. That kind of like flips between them, so.
Yeah.
Might be different in that case.
So it's still possible, but probably more complicated too, yeah. Okay.
I think in that article, that was linked somewhere in the chat, the free and co-free thing, there is actually an example of using co-products to kind of give you two interpreters which are composable. So you can kind of, you can write different parts of your DSL using different structures. Then you can use co-products to join them together, and you can use, I think, yeah, as well, products or co-products to actually join the comonadic interpreters. So there is some stuff definitely for where you don't have a fully regular tree structure, but there are some trees which you can't represent using free or co-free. I mean, there are other things that sort of help when you are manipulating those structures, like there's some other libraries out there like UniPlate and things like that in Haskell, where you have more irregular data. But yeah, I mean, Free and Cofree are definitely useful a lot of the time. Like they most situations they work, seem to work wherever we've come up with them. So yeah, useful tools for sure.
Yeah, and Rightful mentions free applicatives. Is that like free applicatives, like relatively different concept completely just from the normal free? The free normal free is like the free monad, right? But free applicatives,
it's quite similar, but there's a bit more. So there's a bunch of different ways you can formulate the free applicative that are all kind of the same in terms of the types, but they work out in different ways. They have sort of different characteristics when it comes to inspecting them. So one of the advantages you get from free applicatives is you can look deeper into the structure that you've created and sort of optimize it and things like that. There is a free applicative library in PureScript as well. And it's pretty handy because we actually use it in Halogen to allow us to pretend that our free monad is supports parallel operations. So, I mean, at the time that you make something parallel, it just basically turns it into a free applicative. But then later on, we'll use the actual parallel f or something to interpret that as well. So you can do a lot of stuff which is similar with free applicatives, but it doesn't have the sequencing that you have with a monad. So it's kind of like the same normal restriction of, you know, if you're writing a parser using applicative combinators, you can't do something where the remainder of your program depends on a prior value sort of thing. So they're both more flexible for certain things, but less powerful because you haven't got the sequencing that, you know, bind and monads give you. So, I mean, free in general is a concept which applies to any of these category structures or algebraic structures. So in the kind of concept of it, yeah, free is not actually that dissimilar to having a free functor or a free monad or free whatever you've got. So yeah,
and there's free structures for basically anything, like Gary said. So like you could have, if you think of,
there's a free semi-ring in a library somewhere, for instance, as well.
So you can think of, you know, the, like if you had like a monoid of, like, you know, strings, you kind of like smash things together, you can think of like the free version of a monoid as being a list or an array, where you can lift anything that's not necessarily a monoid. If you just put it in a list, then you get like a free monoid and you can just kind of smash those together and you can see how they were smashed. And it's kind of, you can kind of do that for just about, for, I don't know, probably any structure. I mean, any algebraic structure like that. So you can do it for like alternatives, which is kind of like the same idea of just like an alternative is like a monoid that's just been lifted to work over functors. And you can do the kind of the same thing. And you're embedding functors inside of a list instead of just like, so, you know, there's other ways to look at it too. I mean, other free structures. So, all right, do we want to move on?
Yeah, we certainly should.
Let's do it.
All right. All right, so let's talk about virtual DOM and PureScript. I think I'll probably, since we don't have much time, there was a bunch of like history on like virtual DOMs and what they're used for. I mean, I can go over that, but if you want to just get to like the nitty gritty and like get it over with, I can skip that. So what do we want to do?
Skip it.
Nitty gritty.
Okay. As far as just going over like why, you know, things that people use to build UIs, you know, why virtual DOM is useful. So I wanted to start by like looking at kind of some other, you know, if you're going to implement a virtual DOM library, you want something fast. So I kind of originally wanted to look at, you know, just some other ones. And I'm in Chrome, so most of these are pretty fast. And it's kind of funny because like mine's the library is actually kind of like in the middle with regards to other JavaScript implementations in Chrome, but like in Firefox is actually faster than a lot of them too. So I don't know what that's about. I think it's because Firefox is just slower in general at like DOM stuff and repainting. But if you wanted to look at, this is just like a DOM repainting test or like a for various libraries. So like let's do like Backbone. This is raw Backbone. It's pretty fast, pretty good. It's about 40. It optimizes, kind of jumps around, but there's this like 40, this frames per second down in the corner. So it's around 40, which is pretty good. Some of them are a lot faster. Like some of them are just insane. I think, you know, because some of them also use like, you know, request animation frame to defer paints and stuff like that. So they can run a little smoother. But then if you go to like look at React, I'm looking at the naive implementations. This one's like around, this one's hovering at 50 or so, 50 frames per second. Maybe here's vanilla JS, vanilla JavaScript. It's maybe around 30, upper 20s, 30. So just to give you kind of like a frame of reference for if you're going to implement like a virtual DOM system, then it kind of has to be fast. It has to be gotta have some speed, and it has to be competitive. Otherwise it's not really, you know, and the main constraint is just that PureScript is not very fast. I don't know if any of you have ever profiled PureScript code, but in general, idiomatic PureScript code tends to be pretty slow just because, you know, it generates a lot of garbage. Like if you use anything, we're going to look at what makes it slow. You know, currying is one thing, and this is kind of something, you know, some people, you really want like auto curry, you know, uncurrying kind of helps. When you have a lot of curried functions, you can generate more heap objects because of closures, which just adds to garbage. And so sometimes it's not actually that big of a deal for speed, but it makes a big deal when it comes to like GC. And so if you're writing something that has to be run all the time, then you have to be more sensitive to GC because you can get some, you know, pauses on it. But type classes, like the implementation for type classes is pretty naive, at least in the code gen. And so what we call entailed type classes. And so I may request a monad constraint, but I may only use the functor in some places, and it actually generates new objects every time you have to like find the entailment of a type class. And so it tends to generate a lot of garbage because it creates these new type class dictionaries all the time. If they're parameterized. If they're not parameterized and you don't use entailment, then it can be okay. But you end up using more currying in that case because each type class is a curried argument. And this affects his data. So we have like the F data, which represents kind of like our opaque effects. And it's actually a hunk of data. It's a heap allocation. So when you generate a new F, it doesn't run the effect immediately. It creates a closure that has code to run your actual effect. And so when that bubbles up to our main function through a series of, you know, binds and calls is when it actually gets run. So this affects as data is going to add some overhead, and kind of the same way that currying adds overhead, in that you'll tend to have more heap allocations due to closures, which just generates more garbage, and which can cause slowdown due to garbage collection. So, but we do have some available optimizations. We have explicit uncurrying with makefn and runfn, and this will just inline the arguments instead of generating a curried version. We have magic do, which eliminates the overhead of the F bind calls. So F binds just end up becoming, you know, sequential JavaScript statements. So you don't have any of like the type class overhead in that case. And there is ST to some extent. And I know like ST variables or references can be optimized to just like variable mutations. But you know, most of the implementations that most of the stuff that we do, it tends to be like mutating maps and arrays and stuff like that. And those don't really quite get in line the same way. And so you still end up having this kind of, you still end up with all like the closures for effects in that case. So I didn't actually, I didn't really have a use case for ST. And, so I actually ended up writing just some basic FFI functions just to do some of the ST-like implementations that I would have used otherwise. And so it generates a lot less garbage in that case. But if you look at virtual DOM implementations, there's kind of like two ways to implement them, and they're called like two pass and one pass. And two pass is where you take two different trees, two different virtual DOM trees, and you generate a patch set So you walk those two trees, see how they're different, and you generate a patch, a list of, you know, or like a set of instructions for how the DOM needs to be patched. And then diffing yields a patch set, you synchronize with the DOM by interpreting the patch set. So then once you get your patch set, you walk it and you mutate the DOM based upon the patch set. And so then there's just like single pass, which is just syncing as you diff. You don't generate the intermediate diff, like diff set, and you just mutate the DOM as you go. And I think more virtual DOM libraries now just go this route because it tends to be a little simpler, but it does, a lot of implementations require or depend on tree mutation. So like once you pass in your virtual DOM tree, once you diff it with another one, it actually kind of has to mutate the tree that you passed in with like different things. So it kind of has some sort of context for the next time you go through. So you don't actually have like this pure data structure anymore that you can interpret. You actually have some other stuff going on. So you have to make sure you thread them correctly. But so when I was thinking about how to implement it, I chose it just because I kind of been messing around with it. And this is the idea of machines. And I'm not going to go, this is kind of nitty gritty, but it's the idea of, what is it, the finite automata with like mealy and more machines. And in particular, I was looking at mealy machines. And there's this data type that we have in PureScript machines called mealy t. And basically, it's kind of like an effectful function that dynamically unfolds as you run it. And so you have this computation here, this A, M step. And so when you provide it an A, it gives you an M, gives you an effect, some sort of effect. And then once you run the effect, it gives you a step. And after when you look at the step gives you some value, but then it gives you the next thing to run after it. So this kind of naturally unfolds. And so each time you run it, each mealy t that you yield in the step may have some other context with it so that it can do something different the next time when you run that step. And then you'll get another step out of it, and this keeps going. And in the data type in particular in PureScript machines has this halt constructor so that the process can actually kind of halt itself. It's it may not be infinite, and so it can just like stop at any given time. And so if it yields a step with halt, you can't run it anymore. And so I took this data type and I modeled the same idea, but instead of to make it work for virtual DOM, like the virtual DOM process doesn't really choose to halt. It's something that kind of just runs infinitely and you just keep feeding it with input. You keep feeding it with a new tree to patch. But at any given step, the program, whoever's running the program, might decide that it needs to be stopped. And so I took the halt out. It used to be a sum type in step. And I took it out and put it in emit so that it became a product. So now this is models like a potentially infinite process that someone can then choose to stop, once its time is up. But someone else gets to decide this. The machine doesn't decide this. That was just illustrating the halt aspect of it. And if you look at, there's actually, I'm not going to go over these, but this is actually a fairly interesting type. You can implement tons of instances for this if you wrap it in a new type. I just left it as a type alias over a function just because, for my purposes, it was a lot simpler. And I didn't really have a whole lot of uses for all the instances because they would be really slow. And so I just left it. But just FYI, if you put a new type around this, you can implement tons of useful stuff over it. And I think this is actually the basis for, there was a talk at, I think, ICFP, last time around about monadic signal functions, and I think this is the same type as monadic signal, or like effectful signal functions. But this data type is cool because it gives us the opportunity for initialization of a machine, which is our render. It allows for transitions, so we can do our diff patch cycle, and it allows for finalization. So in each step, I can yield a finalizer, and someone can choose to halt that process. And in which case all the resources that it had allocated could be cleaned up. So like DOM nodes and stuff like that could be cleaned up or removed from the live DOM. So if you wanted to look at like the tree or the core type of this virtual DOM tree type, maybe there's a way to model this with Free. I don't know. I haven't tried. But this is just kind of what it looks like. Because when I was implementing this, I wanted it to be extensible. Because I know we had used the JavaScript, you know, virtual DOM library like proper, and you know it has this concept of widgets, so that you can extend it the diff and patching cycle with your own sorts of things, and so you could implement maybe a component system on top of that. And so I like this idea of extensibility that I wanted to bake into it. And so with this data type, this VDOM data type, you know, representing like this DOM tree, you know, you start with just basic text. This is like our text nodes. You'll have like your elems, which is just your virtual DOM nodes, like the element nodes that have children. And the keyed stuff is just something, you know, as kind of a, most virtual DOM implementations have what's called keying, and it just allows you to kind of treat your children as sort of a kind of an ordered map instead of just a straight list. And that allows you to preserve some identity in your children. So it allows kind of things, it's kind of an optimization, so you don't have to do like this like full crazy diff patching. It allows you to keep the patching pretty simple and local. And but it allows you to preserve identity just among the children, so that if you swap the keys around, then that element actually gets swapped around in the DOM and doesn't do anything unnecessary. But then I just created an extra widget, whatever. And this isn't set to anything in the core VDOM type. So we'll just say this widget is kind of our extension point for this tree type. And this is like the W is kind of like the functor part of it, right? And the A is just another, this is the type for attributes. So this VDOM type is actually a bifunctor. So it's got two variables that can be substituted. The A is the type for attributes. And as you see in the data type, there's no attribute type baked in. And I wanted to keep that flexible because different libraries might choose different attribute types. And there's all sorts of cool things that you could do with that by like keeping attributes abstract. You know, you could maybe like, you can hang type classes off of them. You can do sorts of like cool stuff with them. Like, you know, maybe you want like an implementation for attributes that allows you to do like drag and drop and like this other kinds of like, so I mean, I don't know, there's just some cool things that you could have, that you could kind of like request from, like, if you keep it as a type variable, you can like request things from it, which is kind of neat. And, but otherwise it's got this weird little grafted, this is just kind of an optimization.
You probably should have left this one off for the presentation.
Yeah, I just left it in here, but you know, but it is nice to know what kind of optimizations are available in it. And this grafted type is kind of complex, but, and I'm not going to go through the implementation of it, but this graph X is like this existential kind of trickery. But all it does is it provides us with something really cool because it's a functor, but it can be really inefficient. As we talked about with free, you know, if you want to get down to the leaves and change the leaves, it's really inefficient to traverse the entire structure every time. And due to the way we use kind of like the functor instance of this tree type a lot, it can be, or at least like more, a lot of virtual DOM types where like the actual functor part, the type variable is kind of what we have used for inputs, like for events. So like input messages for the, so we end up using the functor instance a lot to like change that. And it can be really expensive if you do that over a tree many times, like if you're building up like kind of like a tree of components. And so this grafted is just like it's a kind of like a special optimization. And what it does is it gives us map fusion. And map fusion just means every time you map over the tree, it doesn't actually map it. It kind of defers the map and it just builds up like a node of all the functions that we're going to apply over the tree. And then when we go to actually inspect it, then we can actually apply it. So we may do multiple mappings. If you do 10 mappings, you know, if we had to traverse the entire tree 10 times, then that would be really, really slow. And so, but by having it's a coyunata, which is is kind of the free, we talked about free, other free things, and coyunata is what's called the free functor. And it's really useful for things like this, because instead of mapping multiple times, it just builds up a function composition of all the things that you've mapped. And then when you go to inspect it, then you can apply it. So my 10 mappings just turns into one map in the end. So it provides a nice optimization opportunity. And but if we're going to look at like an example machine and everything, while that machine data type was kind of abstract over M, everything in the implementation of the virtual DOM library of the VDOM, Halogen VDOM is, you know, it's monomorphic to F just to take advantage of, you know, the magic do stuff. So if we're going to look at like an implementation, this is kind of a, this doesn't have any like of the uncurring stuff applied to kind of keep it clear, but you can kind of see how this builds. And so you start, when you initialize it, the first step is going to be your rendering effect. So given our string input, if you look V to up there at the top, VDOM machine F string to DOM node, this is a machine that takes a string and yields a DOM node. And so our initial step is going to be the rendering step. And it's going to create a DOM node based upon the string, and then it's going to yield a step. And the next step, or it's going to yield the step with the node, but it provides the next step. And the next step is going to be the patch process. So whenever the next time you pull this out and apply the next DOM tree, it's going to run the patch process. And the patch process has the previous node baked into it through a closure, and the previous string baked into it through a closure. So we get kind of like this kind of like hidden state, so we don't have to model it all like in this huge tree type. And then it will just diff based upon the incoming string. So it'll look at the new node, and if the new node is also a text, then we'll kind of see if the text is the same, the string one is the same as string two. If it's not the same, we'll set the text content on the node. And then the next step after that will just be another patch process. And each time it yields a finalizer, and this finalizer, this is actually old code. The new finalizers always remove the DOM node, or remove the nodes from the tree whenever it's done. So whenever you call like the halt finalizer, and this one is just pure unit, doesn't do anything, but in the current implementation, it removes itself from the live tree. It does its own cleanup. And so we have to put in this special case for like grafted, because it's all baked into this structure, we have to unfold it so we can actually do the diffing. But that's kind of neither here nor there. That's the optimization working. And if it's something else, if it's a text, I can't really diff a text with like an elem, and all it would mean was that I would replace the text with the elem. So I'm just going to start over on the new process of building a VDOM from the new one, and it's going to render that and add that node to the tree. But if you insert all like the optimization opportunities, like the uncurring stuff, this is what it looks like. So you go from this to this. It's not that. It's not too bad, but it does add some nastiness. I originally implemented it like this in the curried way, and it was completely unusable. Like I opened it up in Chrome when I first wrote that repaint test for it. I opened it up in Chrome and it worked, and I was like, okay, so it was like 15 frames per second or something, and it was working. And then after about 20 seconds, it just halted, like totally just locked up the browser. And it was because it was doing so much garbage collection. And so it just became totally unusable. So I went through and I made sure everything was uncurried, everything that possibly could. Anything that used allocations for like type classes, like pure and all that, I wrote, you know, monomorphic aliases for it so that it would never, you know, it always, you know, only one argument for it, stuff like that. So, you know, all this kind of crazy stuff had to kind of go through. But as far as like the usage goes, you know, you have this machine, this initial machine that knows how to interpret the core tree type. And you pass it in the initial render. So you might, you know, based on some state. So I'm going to render a tree based on a state. Create a new machine out of it. I get a node out of that. And so I can extract the node from the machine. That's the value that it yielded. And I can append that to the body. And that basically starts everything. And then whenever I want to transition the DOM tree, I just run the next step. So like I'll step over machine one with a new render tree. That gives me another machine. And when I do another patch, I step over that machine with a new render tree. And each time you step over it, it gives you a new machine, a new way to patch that knows how to patch the existing tree that's in the DOM. So this is like the way of syncing the virtual DOM to the actual DOM. So I was going to see, let's look at the actual implementation here. Hopefully it's not too bad. Sometimes, you know, it's pretty uneven. As far as like, sometimes I'll open it up and like all these, all like the virtual repaint tests, doesn't matter the library. And so sometimes they'll be super fast, sometimes they'll be kind of slow. And so, you know, maybe hopefully I'll be favored today. And so you'll see this is a naive implementation, and this is about 40 frames per second. It goes peaks at about 40 to 45 frames per second. So that was kind of like in the same ballpark as the other virtual DOM implementations I showed before. And you know, I can do an optimized, let's see. If I go in here, I'll swap out I'm getting pinged. If I swap out the naive implementation with like slightly optimized representation, this is the same kind of optimizations that all the that all of them kind of use for their optimized versions. Run a new build. And it can, so I was peaking at about 45. Oh, this isn't right. It's not any better. Maybe I didn't do it right. Did it not build? Anyway,
it's
about 60 frames per second. So, you know, I may not be hitting it right or something.
Did you change it in the code? It looks like it didn't comment out.
Yeah, it's the same, but it's supposed to be quite a bit faster. Like I said, it's kind of uneven. Sometimes it's fast, sometimes it's slow, depending on what my computer's doing.
I can see 60.
Oh, you can? Is it running?
No, I'm lying, but I'm pretending.
All right. Well, that was kind of anticlimactic, but yeah, it does. At least in most tests I've run, it'll peak higher, but maybe it's not refreshing or something, I don't know. But anyway.
It could be that it's still cached because
Yeah, I don't know. But anyway,
a hard refresh or something.
But anyway, that was my demo. At least the naive one worked. And it at least shows that the naive implementation of a rendering that is it's comparable to some other JavaScript libraries. Not all of them. There's some that are like super fast. I mean, just like crazy. They just take like every V8 optimization and just go to town with it. And you know, and some of them get like super fast. And you know, but you can also do like the same thing of adding like a request animation frame type thing. And that helps quite a bit. That has its own issues, at least for building like a library based off of it. But that's not something that I actually care about as far as like in the actual virtual DOM library, the Halogen VDOM. But, you know, the performance ceiling is really all just about allocations. And like that's every, you know, I did some performance testing on like the latest Halogen version. The new version of Halogen has a lot of cool stuff in it. Like it's actually all component updates are completely local. So it doesn't have to patch the entire tree. It just patches the local component. And so that makes a lot of use cases a lot faster in and of itself. But at least all like the profiling I've done is just like GC is just still kind of goes crazy. It's a lot better, and it's at least consistent. Like, you know, the frame rate is consistent. It's, you know, 40 to 45. It doesn't like drop down too low. And so at least it's consistent, but it's still a lot of time is still taken up in GC. But you know, automatic uncurring would be nice, at least for this use case. It's not too bad with this implementation. You know, this is kind of like an optimized library, so I don't really mind inserting it too much. But you know, it's kind of fragile. Like I've written some. I can show you some weird spots in the code that I've had to like write things in a really weird way just to get like the code to generate in the way that I wanted it to. But I think what would really be cool is if we could like kind of like inline the effect definition. So instead of building that extra thunk that represents the F, if we could actually inline that code, and so that we don't actually have any of the extra heap allocation for those thunks, and it just turns into like a straight inline and, you know, a straight imperative program like you would with JavaScript. And I mean, that's the end of that. I kind of wanted to show you just a little bit of what it looks like. You know, it's kind of ugly, just because it's using that optimized code. So this is the latest implementation. You can see there's like this finalizer here. This is like the cycle of the machine, the life cycle of it. So it starts with render, and it transitions to the patch. And then when you're done with it, it'll call done. And so that gives us like the whole life cycle of it. And you can see I had to write some stuff with the FFI. You can see like these, on this, on that. And this uses this util diff with IXE, which is just a monomorphic F thing that just kind of, that, you know, it's just a for loop basically. And so to avoid it, it loops over it, but it also builds another structure with it so that I don't have to use ST. And so this is just, they're kind of, but it's a pretty general patching or kind of like diffing. It's, you know, it's only, it's not very long. It's just very basic. So all the logic, all the, like the hard like diffing logic still exists in PureScript. And that's kind of the goal, is that I wanted to write something in PureScript, as much in PureScript as possible without having to defer to the FFI in that. And, this is like the keyed implementation. It's basically the same as the element one, but it just uses some different functions, does slightly different stuff. But, you know, that's about it. Oh, some of the weird things that I had to do. So PureScript, the code that it generates for if statements is bizarre. Like, cause it deshears it into a case statement. So it basically turns into like, if, you know, T, run this, but then it does else, or no, it just turns it into another if and does not T that. And then, but sometimes this messes with the F inliner. And so since it turns it into a case statement, it ends up generating this extra iffy around it. And so you'll get like this extra stuff wrapping your code around like all of your if statements instead of using like a ternary. And that just adds, sometimes in weird places, it can add like some weird indirection. But if you use a case statement like this, case true with a wildcard, you know, it removes the extra wrapper, and then your else branch just gets in, it's just if, and then the else branch immediately after it. So it kind of, so I have to like make sure like to take care. The same with like pure. Sometimes I can use pure and it fires with the magic do, but sometimes I have to use a partially applied version of pure for F so that it doesn't, you know, create another argument for the dictionary, stuff like that. So it just has to do all this like little weird, this kind of like weird stuff to specialize it. And if you actually look at the code, it's just kind of, so look at the output generated. You know, it generates actually really straightforward JavaScript.
Yeah, that's beautiful relative to other outputs I've made.
Yeah. And it's actually funny because this is, what, 264 lines of JavaScript that it generates. And the actual pure script is 245, you know. So the JavaScript outputted, because I had to write in kind of what's basically funny type JavaScript, the code that's output, that the compiler spits out, is basically the same size. So anyway. So it does end up optimizing pretty nicely, though, at least. And that's it.
Yeah, there's some cool questions in the chat.
I haven't been following the chat while doing it, so let's see what we got.
Yeah, Rifle was wondering if you could use guards instead of, I think she asked that at the time of the if statements you were discussing just a few minutes ago.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't tried it, so it's a possibility. It would just be like a wild card with a guard after it. That might work. I'm not sure. But anyway, so yeah, it's basically the same. It ends up being kind of the same thing, but it probably generates the same code. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I was also curious about the request animation frame. Like, that seems like a pretty nice optimization, like limiting how many times your program runs. Like have request animation frame trigger when you're diffing starts.
Well, so that just becomes a wrapper. I actually have
Okay.
In the repaint test, I have a version that uses request animation frame. And when using apps, like we don't use it in Halogen, and I'm kind of, you know, there's some trade-offs when using request animation frame. It's good for repaints, but when actually like doing updates, like when you're doing asynchronous updates, you can end up updating things. Like you may get events too fast and you'll end up patching it. Like if you have inputs, you know, like you have a text input and you're like typing really fast, the input will come in and say it's this value. And then when it tries to apply it, you've already updated it, but it doesn't know that because it's an asynchronous patching. It'll try to override it with an old value. And that's kind of what gets kind of like the weird jank. So you can't use what are called controlled form inputs, which is form inputs that are controlled by the value in your state. They have to, it can only set like the initial value of it. And so there are definitely some trade-offs. I'm, you know, we don't implement it in Halogen. We haven't had really issues with it. So, you know, React doesn't use request animation frame out of the box. And, you know, Elm uses it, and it has the, and it has that problem of dealing with inputs. And the problem with that is that you only set the initial input value. Is that when you're dealing with like a global tree, I may set the initial input value here, but if I patch it to conceptually another new component, but it tends to overlap, if it happens to overlap with that input, it might not actually set the new value again. So you have like some trade-off there. You have to make sure to use all your like keying in the right spot. So it tends to, you kind of have to think about the implementation more when you use request animation frame. But it does, it can, especially in Firefox, it's a lot faster. Like Firefox will do like a clean 60 FPS pretty much all the time then.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that that request animation frame had any effects like that. I just heard of some success cases like, oh, I started using request animation frame and everything turned out great.
It's funny because there's like, there's lots of like the form inputs especially are kind of like the thing, and virtual DOM, the implementation of the Halogen VDOM kind of takes care of like major edge cases. And one of them is, it's always setting text on inputs is one of them, or like how, when you set like the, if you have like an option dropdown, you know, because sometimes if you set the selected value, it doesn't apply correctly. So there's some weird little edge cases here and there. And so it kind of takes care of those big ones. But if you're going to implement it with request animation frame, which is deferred to the actual thing that's going to drive the patching process, then you kind of have to keep that in mind. So your users can't reliably use controlled form inputs, if that makes sense.
It's possible to use like non-controlled form inputs, right? Yeah. I've not tried it myself. I'm just curious if it's possible.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess part of the thing is as well, you don't really need to do that in VDOM itself because you could use request animation frame on like changing state that actually forces a re-render. So like,
yeah, so it's left for the driver, whatever library is going to like actually run virtual DOM. Virtual DOM is just concerned with like the patch process. And so when you actually apply the patch processes up to whatever is running, whatever the library is doing. So it's not really something to implement directly in Halogen VDOM.
Yeah, Halogen VDOM is kind of minimal in what it provides. Like it does all the stuff you actually want from your patching and whatnot, but it's not there as like a full on, you know.
It's not a library itself. And so,
yeah.
But yeah, Halogen is using it. The next version is using it. And so it's cool because you, like I said at the start, you can build UIs with just the normal PureScript toolchain. You don't have to use NPM or node modules or anything like that. So that's pretty nice.
And so you could also implement like Elm's lazy on top of this, where you run the patching process when the state actually changed, right?
That's actually what the optimized thing was supposed to do. I don't know why it wasn't triggering, but yeah, it's a thunk implementation or like, and so, yeah, it just ends up being like a little kind of like an existential thing. You bundle up a render function with some value and it does a referential comparison whenever you patch it. And so if the referential comparison is different, then it'll run the new render function again. Otherwise, it just short circuits that tree. And there are some trade-offs for that as well because it's referentially compared and you're referentially comparing the function as well. You know, you just have to keep that in mind whenever you're like implementing it. Sometimes you can get to a case where you think it should be firing and it doesn't because you're actually passing a new argument or you have to parameterize the render somehow. So you just, you know, that's again kind of a trade-off of getting it to be faster. Halogen doesn't implement that just because every component is thunked automatically. Everything is done explicitly based on state changes. And so because every component renders locally, there's not really a need to do a thunking implementation because everything is just thunked automatically. Every component's thunked automatically.
Yeah, that's cool. Get to 45 frames per second still. It's quite an achievement. I've played around with virtual DOMs in the past. Oh, man.
Yeah, that's really impressive. Nice work on that.
And I mean, I'm sure, because once you start profiling with the different browsers,
Yeah, they're all pretty different. But
it's all crazy. It's really crazy. But I'm still wondering, you probably could push more out of speed out of it if you were to profile the JavaScript that it pumps out as well.
That's what I've been doing, is just running like the Chrome Dev Tools profiler on it. I would love to, I would like to be able to see. I was hoping that maybe I wanted to test the rollup plugin because it started doing some inlining, and I was going to see if it did any sort of inlining with the effects, but I'm not sure if it does. But I was going to make a feature request to do that.
Yeah.
Because I'd like to play, see if that actually does have a good effect on it. But it'd be cool. Yeah.
That'd be interesting. Cool. Thanks for that.
Yeah, I mean, that's all I got.
That was good. I really like the first one. Yeah, I'd never seen trees before. So, well, I've seen trees, but yeah, not in terms of the tree and the way they work. Sorry, I've got so many bad jokes. I've got a name for myself. Gary just gave me the, if I get something named after me, it's going to be a core. Like the, what was the other one? The co...
Co-United, yeah.
Yeah, that's all right. I'm going to be the co-or. Yeah, it doesn't.
Well, I always joke with like Gary too with the tree stuff. Like, whenever we're like trying to model something, we'll say, "I'll say, like, just Cofree compose that. You can build. You know, all you need is like to solve like all your data modeling problems. Just Cofree compose it.
Everything. Yeah, that's cool though. Yeah, it's really impressive.
Yeah, well, Nathan, is this presentation that'll have used up your bandwidth a month, probably, will it?
I know, I'm actually at my mother-in-law's house. So I live out in the Texas woods. So I have satellite internet with like a terrible, it's like a 30 gigabyte per month bandwidth cap.
Oof.
Yeah, so I had to relocate today for this. So. Well, and it's satellite, so it's like it ends up being like a 4-second delay, like over a secure connection to get like the ping back. And so you'll start talking, and so you'll just end up talking over each other, and that happens all the time.
Like, yeah, we have some really awkward conversations.
I was just earlier, like with Christoph, he was doing a little screen share, and it was like 30 seconds off, and he'd be doing something, and you're like, oh, I'll type something, and then you wouldn't get it for about 30 seconds, and that's painful. Yeah.
Hey, Nate, I got a quick question about the VDOM implementation. Would that be usable from outside PureScript? So if you were just using a JavaScript project for work and you wanted to use this VDOM implementation, is there a strange interface because of PureScript currying or whatnot?
The interface is strange just because you have to build the tree. So, I mean, you could write a wrapper that because you're calling the constructors. They're raw PureScript constructors. So you would just have to expose something that made the constructors a little more palatable, I guess. And you could call it from JavaScript. Most of the functions, there's some currying, but most of it's uncurried, or it's just only one argument anyway. Like, to feed in the new input is a single argument. So, but yeah, you could. It's feasible.
Interesting.
It's not going to be fast. Like, if I was going to write it from JavaScript, I'd probably just use a faster JavaScript one.
Yeah, cool. Well, yeah, I guess we could wrap up the talk here then. Much appreciated, Nate, for you putting together that awesome talk on explaining free.
It's good practice, too. You know.